as you promised me that I was more than all the miles combined. You must have had yourself a change of heart like halfway through the drive, because your voice trailed off exactly as you passed my exit sign. Kept on driving straight and left our future to the right. Now I am stuck between my anger and the blame that I can't face. The memories or something, even smoking weed does not replace. And I am terrified of weather, cause I see you when it rains. Doc told me to travel, but there's COVID on the planes. And I love Vermont, but it's the season of the sticks. And I saw your mom, she forgot that existed.
You're not supposed to see me right now. This is tomorrow.
I am.
She's so sad.
I'm seeing what comes out.
Thank you so much.
I'm split in half, but that'll have to do. So I thought that if I piled something good and all my bad, that I could cancel out the darkness I inherited from Dad. No, I am no longer funny, cause I miss the way you laugh. You once called me forever, now you still can't call me back. And I love Vermont, but it's the season of the sticks. And I saw your mom, she forgot that I existed. And it's half my fault, but I just like to play the victim. I'll drink alcohol till my friends come home for Christmas, and I'll dream each night of some virgin to you that I
love you.
And I'm split in half, but that'll have to do.
Tequila is your friend.
Your mom, she forgot that I existed. And it's half my fault, but I just like to play the victim. I'll drink alcohol till my friends come home for Christmas. And I'll drink each night of some.
Gonna be a good one.
Might not have, but
it's okay.
Now your heart might be drinking one pair of shoes. And I'm split in half, but that'll have to do.
Is your love tonight?
I'm not making other words.
Take over. I went down and this is good for you guys too. I told
them this now.
Sorry.
It's video. It's good. It's okay.
The phone for the messages. Don't pull it up to your ear. Two people can easily listen to it. It's so loud.
Oh my God.
You got that one yet?
Yeah, you got that one.
Whoa. With what?
What do you think, guys?
I see that.
Is it so cool?
Yeah,
you need a basket. Yes.
Here, you
want to
put your dress on?
Like,
you
ready?
Yeah, you can put your dress on.
Are there towels in there, please?
Not yet.
Oh, not yet. Yeah, okay. We don't want to waste it.
Hello! Welcome to your party!
The veil is so
sweet! So
Oh, great. Did you two are down?
All right, you guys ready?
Okay. Oh, my God. Yeah, Tay-Tay Supreme Princess!
Tiptoed in a room I know you got to have your rest. She says, come lay beside me, I've been waiting since you left. As long as I have you,
myself for a time. Be my soul. Look in these eyes, I know I've before. Be my light. Sunrise, I feel cause you stayed up.
Nathaniel Dodge Cole and Taylor Marie Ross. We gather here in this great setting in this wonderful town, which is officially called New Shoreham, and you guys probably all know it as Block Island. And Nate and Taylor already had a lot of memories, and they already share us this place. And this weekend, we hope to make more memories for them as we celebrate with them. I think I know most of the people here, and I met a lot of people this weekend. For those who haven't met me, my name is Kevin. I'm Taylor's proud stepfather. It's truly humbling for me to be able to officiate their ceremony today. I've been fortunate enough to experience the start of Nate and Taylor's relationship from the winter of 2021 and the almost 4 years since then. But Taylor, Gina, about 80% of that experience has been through Taylor and Gina's consistent communication with each other from about 3,000 miles away. You know, I get some of that secondhand. So if you guys probably picked up on it, a lot of people are anxious for you guys to move back to New England. But in those years, I have been able to witness, you know, their commitment to each other, the love and the faith and the trust they have in their relationship. And I've seen the love in these two grow and these two wonderful people. And like many from Taylor's family, I've been fortunate enough to meet their great group of friends, a lot of which are here today. And also Nate's family too. It's been a pleasure to meet all of them over the years. And I think I talked to some people this morning. I think some of us were in the famous Sonoma Valley wine tour shuttle bus adventure. We all survived that. If people haven't heard that story, then go ahead and ask about that. That's an interesting experience that we had there last year. Well, today and this weekend are mainly about Nate and Taylor. They wanted to make sure they had an opportunity to thank everyone for being here today. They realize that it's not trivial for a lot of folks between cost and logistics and schedules to make it here for a destination wedding. So why don't you guys go ahead and take a look out here and look who's here. And this is probably the only time all these people are going to be assembled together. And while you're doing that, I'd like to please keep in our hearts some folks that would love to have been here today but not able to make it. Nate's mother, Jane, and Taylor's grandparents, Nana and Pop Grandy. Nate and Taylor, all these people here, they care for you, they love you. They were selected by you as your favorite people in the world, right? So we're very happy to be here and celebrate with you. So hope you get an opportunity to thank everyone. So we've all known either Taylor or Nate, or maybe both, throughout the years, and we've seen them growing up as individuals and finding their way through life. And from this day forward, we'll know them as a married couple. Nate and Taylor have an interesting genesis to their relationship. They were actually peers in high school, if people didn't know. I heard rumors that maybe they had their eye on each other, or maybe one of them did. But nevertheless, they never did date in high school. We have to fast forward another 10 years or so. When each of them has been out of high school, been out of college, lived in multiple cities, started on their own career path, and the opportunity arose for them to date, and they took advantage of that, and the path that they chose there has led them on their way so that now they've reached their destination together. It really has been a joy to watch them fall in love and grow in their relationship over the years. It was just as recently as a couple weeks ago, Nate and Taylor had a small gathering for Nate's birthday. Nothing really special, some food, some drinks, some music. But I found myself sitting back and just recognizing the sincere just joy with the group that was there. So that really what made it special. It wasn't so much what we were eating, what we were drinking, it was the people that were there that made it great. And the point being that that's not a unique situation. I think a lot of people here can say that. It doesn't matter where we are, we're with Nate and Taylor, it's going to be fun and we're going to be have a great time. So I think hopefully people that haven't had a chance to do that, you'll be able to do that this weekend as we celebrate with them. So yes, Nate and Taylor, they entered into the relationship as whole and separate individuals, but now the days before they met probably seem like a whole other lifetime, even though it was only maybe several years ago. Already, you two live and act and move as one mind, one body. You're already bound together. Today we just make it official through marriage. I think this next part we'll call the sermon. With my kids, I don't want any laughing or any groaning for sermons. The Grandy and Nolan in-laws know rolling of the eyes. It's only 13 pages, single spaced. So we're good. Yeah, so we hold marriage up as a sacred union between two people who are committed to loving one another and spending the rest of their lives together, faithful to each other and their journey together. But we also know as a society that marriage is a serious institution. It requires deep commitment, faith, and trust in your spouse, and a lot of patience to succeed. And that's why we celebrate wedding anniversaries. When we see someone, a couple that's been married for 30, 40, or 50 years, we acknowledge that as an accomplishment. And people say that marriage requires things like work and commitment and sacrifice. And of course, all those things are true. However, no matter how it looks like in the end, a true and healthy marriage depends on a solid foundation. And of course, that foundation begins with love. And well, what does that mean? What does love mean? I mean, people love chocolate. People love the Red Sox. But is that the kind of love that's needed for a solid marriage? Right? No, of course not. The love that we need comes from being able to make sacrifices. The love that you need comes from being committed to working through everything together and maintaining open communications, even when life is difficult. And the love that's needed makes all that work worth it. Megan Taylor, everyone here is in attendance and we rise you up in joy today. But in a few years or maybe a few months or maybe a few weeks, real life is gonna creep back in and all its challenges. And you guys are going to need to face those challenges together like you've done for the past few years and the challenge that you've already faced. And you'll need to be there as partners. You need to be fiercely committed to each other and fiercely honest. It's gonna take both honesty and commitment because real love depends on both of those. And a successful marriage needs a foundation of love. We've all heard before that marriage is not just a destination, it's a journey. One that will have its good times and its not so good times. So no matter what you two face, it's important to remember that you're in this together. Your mutual love, respect, and support are what you'll need to make it through life's joys and challenges. All right, that's 13 pages. So now, Nate and Taylor, if you guys are ready to proclaim your foundation of love for one another in the sight of all these witnesses, I'll ask each of you in turn to share your personal vows. Are you ready? Taylor, are you gonna go first? Okay.
All right, I'm gonna try not to cry. Actually, Nate really wanted to go first, but I told him I had to, because after he says this, I'd be crying. Okay. Nate, when I think of a single word that captures what you mean to me, home is the one that instantly comes to mind. For many years, I have tried to name different locations, apartments, friends, feelings, home, but nothing quite felt right. I always felt a pull back to Rhode Island. I like to think that pull was an invisible string connecting me to you. Now, even though we're 3,000 miles from Rhode Island, I've never felt more at home. It wasn't the state that was calling me home. It was me, my true home. I remember when we moved in together, just a few months into dating, people probably thought we were a little crazy. As we assembled furniture, ordered takeout, listened to music, and laughed endlessly, that day became one of my favorite memories with you. Then, a few months later, we embarked on a new adventure, moving across the country to San Francisco without knowing a single soul. It was a true test of our relationship, and we passed with flying colors. Exploring a new city, meeting new people, and experiencing countless new things with you by my side only deepens my love for you. You are unlike anyone I've ever met. Your patience, kindness, and genuine friendship to everyone you encounter sets you apart. Being with you brings me a sense of calmness I have never known. Since we've been together, I find myself happier each day, inspired to be a better person and friend, and more relaxed about little things. Just being with you makes everything feel brighter. There are more people like you in the world. The world would undoubtedly be a better place. Nate Cole, I vow to never take you for granted, to grow with you, to continue to explore the world with you, to be a shoulder to cry on and a friend to laugh with, to encourage you to chase your dreams, whether that means starting your own business or simply indulging in late night McDonald's. To always have your back and to always be your biggest fan. You are so much more than my husband. You are my teammate, my best friend, and my everything. I can't wait to share all of life's grand adventures with you and the simple everyday moments with you. You're the one I turn to for everything, and I'm so happy that from now on we'll be the Coles. Every single day with you feels like coming home. I love you.
Yeah, you're so cute.
Beautiful. Well thought out. Oh, excellent. Nate, you ready?
Taylor Marie. To say the last few years have been the best years of my life is an understatement. I consider myself the luckiest guy to get to experience each and every day along your side. I've always heard the word soulmate, but you don't know what that means until you find your person. You're incredibly caring, selfless, patient, and the best support system. Even on my worst of days, you do everything you can to assist me and find a way to put a smile on my face. And as you so often like to remind me, you add the spice to my life. I still recall the conversation on your couch where your work offered you a position only 3,000 miles away from our life in Rhode Island. How you said how crazy that would be to accept a job after you just started dating and how quickly you responded, if you go, I go. That theme has remained consistent in our relationship. Be there for each other. We often say San Francisco is our favorite city, but the best part of San Francisco is you. Shortly after moving to SF, I realized why I fell in love with you when you were diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. After all the tears, the hugs, and the phone calls, you conquered your fears and persevered through one of the most challenging times of your life. Your determination to adapt to a new lifestyle was inspiring, and it made me love you even more. I'm so proud of you and excited to know that I get to stand by your side for all of life's future obstacles. I've always said that there are many steps to get to this point. Well, today we've hit them all and then some. I vow to continue to give you all of my heart, and to be patient, to be kind, faithful, to be respectful, and to be your support system, and to never tire of hearing that infectious, iconic laugh. I promise to continue the pursuit each and every day to be the husband you will always be proud of. My best friend, teammate, passenger princess, Bogey's mom, and the love of my life. I can't wait to see what the future holds for us and to be by your side every step of the way. I love you.
Nate was a little worried that his vowels were not going to pass the test, but Kara looks happy. Ceremony. But Kara looks happy, and that's probably all that matters right now. Beautiful, though. Great job, guys. So now what we'll do next is we're going to continue with the actual official wedding pronouncements. Each of you, Taylor and Nate, should respond with, I do. Nathan, you're going to go first. You ready? Do you, Nathan, take Taylor to be your wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish until death do you part? And do you, Taylor, take Nathaniel to be your husband, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish until death do you part. Taylor and Nate will now exchange their wedding rings. Justin, please bring the rings to Nate and Taylor. The wedding ring is a symbol of binding, a symbol of attachment and belonging and commitment, not of possession, but of partnership. Taylor, we'll start with you. You have your ring ready? You have his ring ready? Yes. As you place the ring on Nathaniel's finger, please repeat after me. Nathaniel, with this ring, I join my life to yours. Nathaniel, I'll now ask you to do the same. As you place the ring on Taylor's finger, please repeat after me. Taylor, with this ring, I join my life to yours. Having now exchanged their vows and their rings, in our presence, Taylor and Nate have in fact pronounced themselves as husband and wife to all of us. I will now ask and challenge everyone in attendance here today that your commitment to the marriage of Taylor and Nate does not begin and end with your attendance at their wedding, that we are not merely just witnesses to their vows, but that we knowingly and dutifully accept the role as part of an extended support team for their marriage. And now, with great pleasure, distinct honor, and the power given to me by the Universal Life Ministry in the state of Rhode Island, I'm happy to pronounce you married, Nate and Taylor, as husband and wife.
Follow me and lead me on and never let me down. asleep as friends with death, but maybe I should get some rest, 'cause I've been out here working all damn day. Blueberries and butterflies, the pretty things that greet my eyes when you call and I say I'm on my way. You and me belong together.
By the stepmother and father of the bride, Trisha and Scott. And mother of the bride, accompanied by the stepmother, Nina and Kevin. And put your hands up for the bridal party.
She transferred to Roger Williams. Before I dive into the nitty and gritty,
I would like to give a few words from Taylor's idol. If everyone could please bow their heads. Bow your head. He was a boy. She was a girl. Can I make it any more obvious? Avril 2002. Thank you. Nate, I told you I'd put that in there. When Taylor transferred to Roger Williams, she seemed to appear out of nowhere. To this day, we still laugh about how our paths crossed. I'm almost certain we met at a Bayside toga party, and I asked Taylor to go through her closet, but Taylor thinks that we were wearing normal clothes, and a random woman told me that we were going to be best friends. We're still not 100% sure, but since then, it's felt like we've been best friends from the beginning. From finding her a fake ID in college so that she could drink with me, to getting her a cat so that I could have a cat, and to asking her to be a roommate so that I could spend more time with her. Aww. We've become closer with each and every passing day, and I wouldn't change it for the world. Cool. Taylor, you're a force of nature, a fiery, loyal friend, a role model to me and many others, and you're as authentic as they come. Even when it comes to admitting minor car mishaps, like hitting the guardrail on the off-ramp, or messaging Ashton Kutcher about your web toes. Oh, God. Nate, you're the calm in Taylor's storm, the grounding force in your relationship, and her escape from Alcatraz. Your ability to absorb every gasp that Taylor exhales throughout the day is truly remarkable. We can only hope one day Taylor will be as calm as you. When Nate told me his plan to propose to Taylor, he described the most elaborate California surprise, a weekend filled with vineyards, dance parties, and so much love. Many of you may not know this, but Nate staked out their engagement location. He scoped out the scenery, checked the angles, made sure the lighting was good, patrolled the parking lot for the least busy time. He thought of everything and did everything in his power to make sure it was perfect. One thing about Nate is if he's going to commit to something, he's going to give it his all. Standing beside you today, watching my best friend now marry her best friend, brings me so much joy. Taylor and Nate, my wish for you is simple. Embrace your uniqueness, support each other's dreams, and find joy in life's journey as a team. May your love continue to inspire everyone around you. Now, before we raise the glass to the Coles, I have one last request of the groom. Please name a woman.
Taylor Cole!
Name a woman! I love you guys.
Alright, settle down, settle down. We're not done. Let them finish. Hello. So, to those folks who do not know me, I am Nate's older brother, Justin. To those who do know me, I'm not exactly sure why Nate gave me the microphone either. It's a risky move, so strap in. I'm also just going to read. I'm the middle child of the family, and so I have long enjoyed life as the black sheep. I've always been the wild card. Bad attitude, bad grades, bad haircut. Somebody said bad at hockey. Low blow. You guys get the point, but honestly, growing up next to these studs, that's our big brother right there, Tyler. He's Jack. Very strong. Growing up between these two handsome devils, anybody would be lucky to play the part of Black Sheep. Don't worry, Nate, I'm not going to stand up here after a couple of drinks and bash you for some cheap laughs. That would be very easy. Instead, naturally, I'm going to recycle a quote once you subscribe Winston Churchill. Of Churchill, it was said, he is just like everybody else, only more so. Now, I see some of your eyes glazing over, so let me get to the point. Nate is a special guy. He's courageous, he's loyal, and he's loving.
He does not back down from a challenge, and he will not stop working until he has met his goals. Nate is just like everybody else, only more so. Back in the late 90s, early 2000s, Nate was a pint-sized blur of platinum blonde hair and missing teeth. He was a fixture of our Sandy Point neighborhood in Portsmouth. The neighborhood kids, Tyler, myself, we were all a few years older and quite a bit bigger than little Nathaniel, but he did his best to keep up, and he took his fair share of lumps along the way. I turned the page. Eventually. One, nailed it. One summer, us neighborhood kids decided to build a tree fort. Some of the older guys were up there in the fort, nailing plywood to a now dead maple tree, and Nate, as always, was milling about below, looking for a role in the job site. And as sometimes happens when 11 and 12 year olds without proper OSHA training get together for big builds, stuff went wrong. While we decided where the kitchen island would be going, someone knocked a hammer off of the fort, and where else would it have landed but smack dab on little Nate's golden-haired head. Tyler and I, surprised to see Nate still standing, could only yell in panic, "Nate, run home!" The dust settled, Ty and I caught up to Nate. He was back home in the arms of Dad, my father Randy, somewhere. Dad decided he'd need a few stitches, and he was combing Nate's curls away from the cut the hammer left, doing his best to keep the bloody rags out of Nate's sight. And then Nate, sensing the gravity of the moment, and suddenly aware of his own impending mortality, looked up for the kitchen floor to the three of us, and through tear-filled eyes said, "I love you guys." We could see in that moment what a fighter Nate would become. What courage he would display in the face of life's adversities and trials, and the love and loyalty he would display for his family, even though I'm not entirely convinced it wasn't Ty who kicked the hammer off the fort. He looks guilty. But even as a little guy, Nate was just like every other neighborhood kid, only more so. It's the same courage that Nate took with him to the hockey rink, where he was just like everyone else, only less so. A little. After Nate's sophomore year, one of his coaches told him he was too small and too weak to play, and that he might be left off the team next season. The next 2 years, Nate's junior and senior year, all he did was rack up points, leading his high school team, along with so many of the guys in here, to a senior year state championship. And not to be salty, but that coach wasn't there any longer to celebrate with the boys. So, it's weird. To work that hard and to achieve so much success in the face of such negativity and pushback, it's a sign of uncommon character, not dissimilar to one Winston Churchill. This trend of my little brother facing adversity with grace is still ever present in Nate. When times get tough, which they often do in life, Nate digs in. More importantly, he does so to protect those he loves. In the spring of last year, we lost our mom, Jane. She was living in Florida. When it became clear that her health was taking a sudden turn, the three of us rushed down to see what we could do for her, or really just to see her, to be with her. It was Nate who arrived a day early, talking with mom's doctors, nurses, friends, in order to paint a picture for Tyler and I of what we would be walking into. Our youngest brother took on the responsibility of leading the way through one of the worst things we've had to endure together. He prepped us in how to talk to her, how to compliment her, talk about her braided hair, to hold her hand. He told us, if the moment got too heavy, if he felt scared, that we should take a breather in the hallway. We had to be strong for Mom. We had to make her feel as comfortable as we could. I don't bring this up to sink the mood, but to illustrate how just seriously Nate takes his vow of marriage. Taylor. You with me? Take it from me. Nate will stand with you through anything and everything. Whether it has been starting a new chapter together all the way across the country, in your tiny kitchen with your perfect dog, or in your less than perfect moments where you've needed someone to lean on while you learn to live life with new health challenges. Nate is the perfect man to face life with, to enjoy its pleasures, to endure its pains. Nate is like everyone else, only more so. Like anyone's brother, only more so. Nate is like anyone's son, only more so. And I just know Taylor, he will be everything you want in a husband, and more so. So cheers to the bride and the groom. I'm out of words. I'm not a talker.
Sheena, to be
called.
Yes, Sheena!
Yes!
Are you getting wet?
Yeah, I'm getting wet.
Just wow. Look at this. It's so beautiful here. For those of you that don't know me, which I'm pretty sure everybody knows who I am, I'm Gina Taylor's mom. I couldn't be more thrilled to have everyone here together for Nate and Taylor. It's been a long road, and there have been a few bumps along the way. But we managed, and we made it through the big three. So a little inside joke. Nate named us the big three because he was like, it's basically like me, Taylor, and Gina are getting married. Taylor, you know how much I love you. You're not just my daughter, you're my best friend, and you're basically my other half. You're my firstborn. You made me a mom, which has been my favorite job in the whole world. You were the first granddaughter after what felt like a never-ending line of boys. And I remember thinking, finally a girl. And then you ended up being surrounded by three brothers that drove me crazy. But growing up, you were so organized. I just remember at Christmas time, you would open up your presents and like line them up. And they would just like sit there forever. And she'd go and look at them and rearrange them, but never open anything. You know, like it was just like this thing. And or if we like went on, out on the boat, or if we went to Block Island or into the Cape House, you would get there and you would open everything up. And I mean, you would get there and like unpack everything and everything was perfect. And you've like always been that way. I mean, even for this wedding, you organized everything down to the last detail with spreadsheets and binders and everything else. People here even joke that they could use your plan for future weddings, just change the name. But the reason I'm bringing this up is that it's gotten to you where you are today. And I'm so proud of everything that you've accomplished. Nate, you've been amazing for Taylor. I can see how happy you make her. You're so patient and kind, and I can see that Taylor is truly at home with you. I couldn't be happier that she chose you to be her husband, and now I get to tease you for the rest of my life. So we're here, we rented a house here a couple of years ago, and we were all there, and like we would go out, and I'd forget something, and I'd have to go back into the house, and the door would be locked. Or I'd have to get something out of my car, and the car would be locked. I'm like, we're on Block Island. Who is locking everything here? And it was Nate. And I was like, Nate, what are you afraid? Someone's going to break in and steal your underwear? Like, what are you doing? And I was calling him mall cop all weekend. But more on a serious note, the two of you have been through some life changes over the past 3 years. You moved across country. Nate, you just lost your mom, and Taylor with her diagnosis of diabetes. But you navigated with love and support for one another, and it was so beautiful to watch. You really have each other's back. It's clear to everyone that you two belong together. And when I was thinking about what I would say today, I thought of like, what kind of advice could I give? And then I realized, you both have it figured out already. You know what's important in life. Your friends, your family, and most importantly, both of you, each other. You travel, you prioritize family, and you make time for your friends. There's something that I read somewhere that says, we all have stuff, we all have possessions, whether they're houses or cars or clothes or whatever it is. But if you were to strip all that away from a person, what's underneath all that? And I think that everyone in this room knows that you two, after taking all that away, are just good people. You're salt of the earth. And I think you make time for what matters. You live simply. You enjoy life. And I admire you so much for that. So here we are on Block Island, my favorite place in the world. You're only a few miles away, but you feel like you're a million miles away. You get here, and there's such a sense of calmness. Everything seems to slow down. You forget about all the crap you left behind, and it's such a great place to meet up with friends. Everyone's just happy here. This place holds so many memories for our family, from being at the beach till 6 o'clock, to boogie boarding, to crabbing, to swimming in Big Pond, to jumping the bridge, cookouts, and running to catch the sunset. And now I get to see my daughter marry Nate here. It just blows my mind. I couldn't be more happy or thrilled that we're here on Block Island to celebrate the two of you. So I just want to take a moment for everyone to stop and pause and soak in and realize we'll never all be together here ever again. And we all made it here for Taylor and Nate. So I hope that, I was just hoping that maybe you could just close your eyes for a second and think about them and the life you wish for them. Right, I just made you all meditate. So the word namaste means a lot of things. but honestly, to me, it means the light in me sees and honors the light in you. And Taylor, the light in all of us sees the light in both of you. And we see the love, we see the happiness, and we couldn't be happier for you. So here's to the adventures you'll embark on, the challenges you'll face together, the countless memories you'll create. May you always find comfort in each other's arms, joy in each other's laughter, and love in each other's every day that you share. So let's raise our glasses to Taylor and Nate, two incredible people who are amazing, but even more amazing together. May your journey be long, your happiness abundant, and your love everlasting. Cheers to Taylor and Nate. Pura Vida, baby.
Yummy, man.
Most of you know, or if you don't know, Nathan's dad. We moved from Massachusetts to Rhode Island, and we quickly moved into Sandy Point. And as the boys got, you know, indoctrinated into the neighborhood, Tyler and Justin, his best men today, had the idea to send Nathan down Sandy Point on a skateboard, lugeing, only in a diaper. So he's lugeing down Sandy Point Ave. He has to lean to come into the driveway, and he picks up more speed, and he ends up getting lodged under the parked car on the driveway. They have to peel him out from underneath the car. He hit his chin and got 3 stitches. So I got the phone call, you got to come home and get Nathan to the hospital. So that was our indoctrination into Sandy Point. And I really hope that the whole process, nobody noticed. The next day, my new neighbor knocked on the door and said, man, oh man, I'm so impressed. I saw a one-year-old lugeing on a skateboard in a diaper only. He said, man, you're going to fit in here great. So that was our start at Sandy Point. And quickly, the boys, you know, were known in the neighborhood, all three of them. But then the next thing, what we called the phase was lugeing Nate. The next phase was the Providence College hockey camp. Every year, we're all hockey players. I would send the two oldest boys to the camp. This particular year, Nathan was too young. I had nobody to watch him. So I went to the camp director and I said, look, I've got two kids at the camp. I've got a younger kid that's not of age. The minimum age was 7. So I talked to him. Nathan was 5. So I talked the camp director into letting him into the camp because I had to go to work. So that same night that I dropped him off, they had a scrimmage that night, and some big kid ran over him and knocked his head to the ice, and I get a call from the camp director. And he says, Nathan, I think, has a concussion. And I'm thinking to myself, he doesn't know losing Nate. This is nothing. This is a drop in the bucket for him. So sure enough, the next day, he headed out and scored a goal and made the top team. And all the Providence College instructors were hockey players for the PC, you know, varsity. And they named him Nate the Skate. And so he became from losing Nate to now Nate the Skate. From youth hockey, I then, years later in the youth hockey, got remarried to my wife Lisa, and she came into the picture. The boys opened her with open arms. But what she really transitioned was a hockey house or locker room into a home. And again, they opened her, you know, with open arms, and in she came, and so a new chapter was born. Then we go into high school, we graduate, but then they win they've already said it, but the Rhode Island State Championship was really something. Yeah. And we got most of those guys here today. Well, that day, as I went out into the parking lot to congratulate them, they were all lined up smoking cigars, waiting to board the bus to go back to Portsmouth, and they were celebrating. But, you know, I'm not the smartest person in the world, but I went up to Nate and I congratulated him. I said, you know what? You will never forget this day, and you will never forget these guys the rest of your life. Well, here they are. So it's awesome. Then we're after high school, we're off to URI. So off goes to college with another hockey player, and then he heads to grad school, goes through grad school. And let's see, you are at grad school. Then around after grad school, he moves to Newport, and then all of a sudden I get a phone call wanting me to meet this girl, Taylor. So I went in and I met him downtown, and I met her, and right away, I knew, I think maybe before him, I went, man, oh man, they were finishing each other's sentences. They were perfect. I couldn't have been happy for him, but almost as a dad, I almost knew it. Kind of. I don't know how I did, but I did. So the next thing you know, he's coming to me and saying, I might be moving to San Francisco. And I said, oh. He goes, well, Taylor has a job going to San Francisco. I said, do you love her? He said, she's great. She's great. And then go. What are you waiting for? Go. And off he went. So, best move he ever did. And I said, you know what? When you're there, you probably fall more in love. And that's exactly what happened. But then, so we've gone from losing Nate to Nate the Skate. Now it comes to Nate the Date. He set a date to get engaged. And the thing he did, I think they already went over it, so I'll cut it short. They kept it a secret from Taylor. Planned a beautiful weekend out in San Francisco. But the plan was for me to fly out there alone. And I would have lunch with him at her favorite restaurant overlooking the Golden Gate Bridge. And he would get down on one knee, come into the restaurant, and have lunch with me, only to find all friends and family, Gina, Kevin, and all the kids hiding in the other room. And when she walked in the front door, she's go, I've got to call my mother. I've got to call my mother. I said, well, call her. But she was in the next room. So she's crying, and around comes the whole family, friends and family, and everybody here today. And Nathan secretly, Nate the Date, kept the date and organized a beautiful weekend with all of us, wine tours, you name it, beautiful Airbnb, and we had an absolute blast. So that's why I kind of called him Nate the Date. Plans for gay decay. Oh, and by the way, she did say yes at the restaurant, so I almost forgot that, and and thank goodness she did. And then, well, over the last couple of years, as they're engaged, almost every weekend they should buy a private jet. They're flying back and forth to Rhode Island because of all these hockey players getting married, and there's bachelor parties, bridal showers, and weddings. It's gone on and on and on, and it's great. So hopefully we can bring it back a little bit closer. This is Oh, and then the other thing we thought, too, the last thing I'll wrap up is we started to notice, this is Nate the Date, that he started all the pictures that he would send home on Facebook and Instagram had that same bridge in the background. And we saw it over and over, and I think all of you did. I think even had t-shirts made. But Nate the Date became Golden Gate Nate. So to wrap it up, we've gone from losing Nate to Nate the Skate to Nate the Date to Golden Gate Nate. But today, the best one yet is the new Mr. and Mrs. Nathan and Taylor Cole. And that one, forever. It doesn't have to rhyme. It sounds great to me. And we welcome you, Taylor, into our family and your family as well.
Personality in everything brings me to my knees. Oh, she shines me up like gold on my arm. I wanna take it slow, but it's so hard. I love to see her face in daylight. It's more than just our bodies at night. But she's really tempting me.